Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Chile Peppers, A Global History by Dave DeWitt. Narrated by Gary Tiedemann. Publisher's note. This audiobook refers to photos included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Introduction. I have been writing this book for 44 years, and I'm not done yet, despite the fact that you're holding it in your hands. That's because my research on the subjects of chili peppers and fiery foods never ends. Just like the archaeological discoveries at Seren that are documented in Chapter 1, some new disclosure about chili peppers will crop up, and by the sheer force of my interest, I'll compulsively write about it. This is my writing niche. It's what I do, and why I'm called the Pope of Peppers. Over those 44 years, I've written, sometimes with co-authors, 42 published books on chili peppers and fiery foods, and hundreds of articles published in magazines and on blogs and websites. I've chosen some of my best writing from past projects for this book, and also added new material that's previously unpublished in print form. So this book is partly a culinary history and partly a memoir about my trips around the world to research chili usage in many different cuisines. Although this book is not designed to be a cookbook, I have selected several representative recipes for each chapter so one can create the flavors they are hearing about in their own kitchens. If one wants more recipes, I have thousands posted on fieryfoodscentral.com. And there's always my book, 1001 Best Hot and Spicy Recipes. Please remember that I am writing about the past, not the present, and that things have changed over the decades. Some of the people mentioned in this book are no longer with us, unfortunately, but fond memories of them linger. Some of the countries my wife and I explored are edgy to the point of being dangerous in certain circumstances, so be careful in all the countries mentioned in this book, and especially when visiting Mexico, Jamaica, and South Africa. Travelers are safer if they stay in designated tourist areas and should always try to find locals as guides, even if they have to be hired. That's the way Mary Jane and I have traveled over all these years, and we've never had any problems at all. We were warned about pickpockets in Rome, narcotraficantes in Mexico, Asian gangs in Cabramatta, Australia, thieves in Belize, and muggers in every large city. But by following a few basic rules, none of the bad guys bothered us. Hang with the locals. Don't try to buy any illegal drugs. Don't get drunk. Don't be loud or call attention to yourself. But do use credit cards and avoid showing a lot of cash. We had a street-smart guide named Tony in Jamaica who drove us all over the island, and I told him to take us only to restaurants where there were no white faces. "No problem, man," he said. And he was right. There were none, because he was with us. One of our black guides in South Africa was shocked when we invited him to have lunch with us. In Barbados, the same thing was a common occurrence. So be adaptable and go with the flow. If offered a choice between an American breakfast and a local one, choose the latter. Smile a lot wherever you travel, and don't be the stereotyped ugly American. The five domesticated capsicum species. Because the species names of the capsicum genus are mentioned so often in this book, I'm placing the definitions here for quick and easy reference. Annuum. The name means annual, which of course is inaccurate, as chilies are perennials in climates where there are no freezes. This is the most grown species in the world, in both gardening and agriculture, and its varieties are commonly known all over the world. The bells, jalapenos, cayennes, anchos, serranos, New Mexicans, paprikas, and ornamentals are all of the annuum species. Bacatum. The species name means berry-like, and it is native to South America, where the varieties are commonly called ají. There are at least two wild forms, varieties bacatum and microcarpum, and many domesticated forms. The domesticated ahis have a great diversity of pod shape and size, ranging from short, pointed pods born erect to long, pendant pods resembling the New Mexican varieties. They are cultivated in most South American countries. Chinense. This species was misnamed Capsicum chinense in 1776 by Nicolaus van Jachin, a Dutch physician who collected plants in the Caribbean for Emperor Francis I from 1754 to 1759. Jachin, who first described the species as chinense in his work Hortus Botanicus Vindobonensis, wrote mysteriously, "I have taken the plant's name from its homeland." He was dead wrong, of course. All capsicums are New World plants. Many people, including myself, believe that the species name should be changed to Capsicum cheiro, which would mean perfumed pepper, because cheiro is Portuguese for aroma or smell. All chinense have a unique aroma similar to apricots. Habaneros and all the superhots, including the Carolina Reaper, the hottest capsicum in the world, belong to this South American and Caribbean species. Frutescans. Tabascos are the most commonly known peppers in the frutescan species, and the name means shrub-like. There is very little pod diversity, and the Brazilian Malagueta variety looks the same as a Tabasco. Tabascos are grown in Central and South America to make the famous sauce of the same name. Pubescans. This is the most obscure capsicum species, and it too has little or no pod diversity. It is the only species with black seeds, and its name means hairy, an allusion to its fuzzy leaves. The pods resemble small apples, hence the common name manzano in Mexico. In South America, they are commonly called rocotos. This species has no wild form, and it is grown in the Andes and also in Oaxaca, Mexico. There are two forms, red and yellow, canarios, and the pods are quite hot, 30,000 to 50,000 Scoville heat units, SHU. 1. The domestication of the wild chili. For more than 10,000 years, humans have been fascinated by a seemingly innocuous plant with bright-colored fruits that bite back when bitten. Although the chili pepper has risen in our estimation from lowly weed to celebrity spice, the secrets of its domestication, its discovery by Europeans, and its subsequent spread around the world are still being uncovered. Often mistakenly thought to be of African or Indian origin, chili peppers are absolutely American. Along with corn, squash, potatoes, and beans, they are among the earliest and most important plants domesticated by mankind in the New World. The tolerated weed. According to botanist Barbara Pickersgill, the genus Capsicum, to which all chilies belong, originated in the remote geologic past in an area bordered by the mountains of southern Brazil to the east, by Bolivia to the west, and by Paraguay and northern Argentina to the south. Not only does this location have the greatest concentration of wild species of chilies in the world, but here, and only here, grow representatives of all the major domesticated species within the genus. Another chili botanist, W. Hardy Eshbaugh, believes that the location for the origin of chili peppers was further east, in central Bolivia along the Rio Grande. Scientists are not certain about the exact time frame or the method for the spread of both wild and domesticated species from the southern Brazil-Bolivia area, but they suspect that birds were primarily responsible. The wild chilies, like their undomesticated cousin of today, the chiltepín, had erect red fruits that were quite pungent and were very attractive to various species of birds that ate the whole pods. The seeds of those pods passed through their digestive tracts intact and were deposited on the ground encased in a perfect fertilizer. In this manner, chiles spread all over South and Central America long before the first Asian tribes moved east and settled the New World. When humans arrived in the Americas between 15,000 and 25,000 years ago, about 25 species of the genus Capsicum existed in South America. Five of these species were later domesticated. However, some of the other wild species were, and still are, occasionally utilized. Two of the five domesticated species of chiles, Capsicum baccatum and Capsicum pubescens, never migrated beyond South America. Baccatum, known as ají, merely extended its range from southern Brazil west to the Pacific Ocean and became a domesticated chili of choice in Bolivia, Ecuador, Peru, and Chile. Likewise, Capsicum pubescens left Brazil to be domesticated in the Andes, where it is known as rocoto. Its range today is primarily in the higher elevations of Bolivia, Peru, and Ecuador, although it was introduced during historical times into mountainous areas of Costa Rica, Honduras, Guatemala, and Mexico. Three other capsicum species that were later domesticated are Anuum, Chinense, and Frutescens. These closely related species shared a mutual ancestral gene pool and are known to botanists as the Anuum Chinense Frutescens complex. They seem to have sprung up in the wilds of Colombia and later migrated individually to Central America and Amazonia. These three species were all in place when humans arrived on the scene, and apparently each type was domesticated independently. Anuum in Mexico, Chinense in Amazonia, and possibly Peru, and Frutescens in southern Central America. These three species have become the most commercially important chilies, and the story of their domestication and further spread is revealed in the archaeological record. The earliest evidence of chili peppers in the human diet is from Mexico, where archaeologist R.S. McNeish discovered chili seeds dating from about 7,500 BC during his excavations at Tamaulipas and Tehuacan. This find and an intact pod from Peru's Guitarrero Cave, dated 6,500 BC, seem to indicate that chilies were under cultivation approximately 10,000 years ago. However, that date is extremely early for crop domestication, and some experts suggest that these specimens are chilies that were harvested in the wild rather than cultivated by man. The common bean, Phaseolus vulgaris, was also found in the same excavation levels, and scientists cannot be certain if they were wild or domesticated varieties. Experts are certain, however, that chili peppers were domesticated by at least 3,300 BC. Ethnobotanists, scientists who study the relationship of plants to mankind, have theorized that during the domestication process, chilies were first accepted as tolerated weeds. They were not cultivated, but rather collected in the wild when the fruits were ripe. The wild forms had erect fruits that were deciduous, meaning that they separated easily from the calyx and fell to the ground. During the domestication process, whether consciously or unconsciously, early Indian farmers selected seeds from plants with larger, non-deciduous, and pendent fruits. The reasons for these selection criteria are a greater yield from each plant and protection of the pods from chili-hungry birds. The larger the pod, the greater will be its tendency to become pendent rather than to remain erect. Thus, the pods became hidden amid the leaves and did not protrude above them as beacons for birds. The selection of varieties with the tendency to be non-deciduous ensured that the pods remained on the plant until fully ripe, and thus were resistant to dropping off as a result of wind or physical contact. The domesticated chilies gradually lost their natural means of seed dispersal by birds and became dependent upon human intervention for their continued existence. Because chilies cross-pollinate, hundreds of varieties of the five domesticated chilies developed over thousands of years. The color, size, and shape of the pods of these domesticated forms varied enormously. Ripe fruits could be red, orange, brown, yellow, or white. Their shapes could be round, conic, elongate, oblate, or bell-like. And their size could vary from the tiny fruits of chiltepins or tabascos to the large pods of the anchos and New Mexican varieties. However, no matter what the size or shape of the pods, they were readily adopted into the customs and cuisines of all the major civilizations of the New World. Pre-Columbian chili customs and kitchens. Chilies were the major spice of the New World and played a role similar to that of black pepper in the Old World. Ancient New World cultures from Mexico to South America combined the pungent pods with every conceivable meat and vegetable. Our knowledge of the pre-Columbian culinary uses of chili peppers is derived from many sources: archaeological finds, Indian artifacts and illustrations of the period, Spanish and Portuguese explorers of the 16th and 17th centuries, botanical observations, and studies of the cooking methods of the modern descendants of the Incas, Mayas, and Aztecs. This examination of the culinary uses of chilies begins in one of the major regions where they were first cultivated, the Andes. It was there that the great Inca civilization came to depend upon the chilies as their principal spice and a major crop. At the heart of the Incan Empire was farming, which determined nearly every aspect of society: the calendar, religion, law, and even war. The Incas were farmer soldiers, likely to be called out of their elaborately terraced and irrigated fields at any time to defend the empire or extend its boundaries. But farming took precedence over fighting, and some later uprisings against the Spanish failed because the Inca soldiers left the battlefront to return to their fields. It has been estimated that more kinds of foods and medicinal plants were systematically cultivated in the Andes than anywhere else in the world at any time. The result of the Incan agricultural expertise included 240 varieties of potatoes, nearly as many kinds of beans, 20 types of maize, plus sweet potatoes, peanuts, pineapples, quinoa, chocolate, avocados, papayas, tomatoes, and of course, several varieties of the beloved chili pepper. The Incan historian Garcilaso de la Vega, known as El Inca, wrote in detail about chili peppers and their place in Incan culture. In his Royal Commentaries of the Incas, he noted that chilies were the favorite fruit of the Indians, who ate them with everything they cooked, whether stewed, boiled, or roasted. He traced the nomenclature of the plant. The pods were called uchu by the Incas, pimiento de las Indias by the Spaniards, and ají by the people of the West Indies, a name that became quite common in the Andes in later times. The Incas worshipped the chili pepper as one of the four brothers of their creation myth. Agar Uchu, or Brother Chili Pepper, was believed to be the brother of the first Incan king. Garcilaso de la Vega observed that the chili pods were perceived to symbolize the teachings of the early Incan brothers. Chili peppers were thus regarded as holy plants, and the Incas' most rigorous fasts were those prohibiting all chilies. According to El Inca, the Incas raised three types of chilies. The first was called rocot uchu, thick pepper, which described the long, thick pods that matured to yellow, red, and purple. The most likely identification of these chilies would be the ají type, capsicum baccatum. El Inca forgot the name of the next type, but wrote that it was used exclusively by the royal household. The third chili he described was chinchi uchu, which resembles exactly a cherry with its stalk. This type, with its name and cherry-like pods both still intact, has survived to this day in Peru and Bolivia. It is the rocoto, a variety of capsicum pubescens, and the only capsicum with black seeds. El Inca noted that the chinchi uchu was incomparably stronger than the rest, and only small quantities of it are found. El Inca also collected some chile anecdotes. Chiles were reputedly good for the sight, were avoided by poisonous creatures, and had been offered as one of the gifts to appease Pizarro and his invading soldiers. As a final culinary note, El Inca unconsciously predicted the spread of chili around the world when he noted, "All the Spaniards who come to Spain from the Indies are accustomed to it and prefer it to all Oriental spices." Thus, the invaders were conquered by the fiery foods of the Incas. Most Incan dishes were vegetarian because fish and meat were luxuries, at least for the commoners. The Incan royalty, however, did consume fish caught in the rich coastal waters and Lake Titicaca, and also ate deer, wild llama, guanaco, and vizcacha, a large rodent. But the royalty would not consume dogs, domesticated ducks, and cuy, guinea pigs, meat sources beloved by the peasants when they could obtain them. The Incas' morning meal was extremely simple. Leftovers from the previous evening and a cup of chicha, a mildly intoxicating beverage made from fermented corn. Around noon, an Inca family would gather for the midday meal, which was prepared by boiling or baking because cooking fats and frying were uncommon. Corn was often boiled with chili peppers, potatoes, and herbs to make a stew called mote. Another midday meal of the Incas was locro, a stew made from sun-dried llama meat, dehydrated potatoes, and chilies. The evening meal was eaten at about 5 o'clock in the afternoon and was usually a soup or stew similar to the midday feast. Potatoes were ubiquitous. But food was not the only use for the beloved chilies. According to historian L. E. Valcarcel, chili peppers were so highly valued in Inca society that they were probably used as currency. Since there were no coins or bills in those days, certain preferred products, like chilies, became part of a rudimentary monetary system. He noted that until the mid-20th century, shoppers in the plaza of Cusco could buy goods with ranti, a handful of chilies. The Incas decorated bowls, dishes, and other vessels with chili pepper designs. Chilies also were the subject of embroidery designs. One example of textile art of the early Nazca period is a yarn-embroidered cotton cloth showing the figures of 23 farmers carrying their crops. One of the farmer figures is wearing chili pods around his neck and carrying a plant bearing pods. About AD 900, a sculptor of the Chavín culture in Peru carved elaborate designs into a sharp-pointed granite shaft measuring 8 feet high and a foot wide that has become known as the Dello obelisk. The principal figure on this obelisk is a mythical creature, the black caiman. The sharp point of the stone corresponds to a real caiman's narrow snout, and the end of the stone is carved with the feet and claws of the reptile, which are holding the leaves and pods of a chili plant. As yet, no scholar has deciphered the meaning of a magical caiman grasping chili peppers in its claws, but the image is suggestive of the magical powers that the people of the Andes Indians believed were inherent in the powerful pods. As chili peppers spread north through Central America and Mexico, they gained the reputation of being not only a spicy condiment, but also a powerful medicine. The pre-Columbian tribes of Panama used chilies in combination with cacao and tobacco, and probably other plants, to enter into hallucinatory trances. According to scientist Mary Helms, these Indians used chilies to travel to the heavens or to the underworld to negotiate with the good and evil spirits on behalf of mankind. Today, the Cuna Indians of Panama burn chilies so the irritating smoke will drive away evil spirits during a girl's puberty ceremony. They also trail a string of chilies behind their canoes to discourage sharks from attacking. I should caution modern sportsmen that the efficacy of chilies as a shark repellent has never been verified. In southern Mexico and the Yucatan Peninsula, chili peppers have been part of the human diet since about 7,500 BC, and thus their usage predates the two great Central American civilizations, the Maya and the Aztec. From their original usage as a spice collected in the wild, chilies gained importance after their domestication, and they were a significant food when the Olmec culture was developing, around 1000 BC. About 500 BC, the Monte Alban culture, in the valley of Oaxaca, began exporting a new type of pottery vessel to nearby regions. These vessels resembled the handheld molcajete mortars of today, and were called suchilquitongo bowls. While the metate was used for heavy grinding, the suchilquitongo bowl was used to mash relatively soft foods. Like a food processor today, the new bowl made it possible to mash foods together to make a sauce. Because the molcajetes are used to crush chili pods and make salsas today, the suchilquitongo bowls are probably the first evidence we have for the creation of crushed chili and chili sauces. Scientists speculate that the suchilquitongo bowls were specifically developed for the purpose of sauce making, and both the tool and the product were then exported. The legacy of the Mayas. A carved glyph found in the ceremonial center of Monte Alban is further evidence of the early importance of chili peppers. It features a chili plant with three pendant pods on one end and the head of a man on the other. Some experts believe that the glyph is one of a number of tablets of conquest that marked the sites conquered by the Monte Alban culture. By the time the Mayas reached the peak of their civilization in southern Mexico and the Yucatan Peninsula, around AD 500, they had a highly developed system of agriculture. Maize was their most important crop, followed closely by beans, squash, chili peppers, and cacao. Perhaps as many as 30 different varieties of chilies were cultivated. They were sometimes planted in plots by themselves, but more often in fields already containing tomatoes and sweet potatoes. The Mayas also cultivated cotton, papayas, vanilla beans, manioc, and agave. They kept domesticated turkeys, ducks, and dogs, and their main game animals were deer, birds, and wild boars. Armadillos and manatees were considered delicacies. For breakfast, the Mayas ate a gruel of ground maize spiced with chili peppers, which is usually called atole, but is sometimes known as pozol. A modern equivalent would be cornmeal or masa mixed with water and ground red chilies to the consistency of a milkshake. For the main or evening meal, stews of vegetables and meats, heavily spiced with chilies, were served. Various pipillans, still served today, are early forms of the mole sauces to come and use two common Mexican chilies, ancho and pasilla. Of course, the Mayas would have served turkey rather than chicken, which was introduced by the Spanish, but either fowl is acceptable. Using the same technology that proved the use of chocolate at Chaco Canyon, New Mexico, researchers have analyzed the contents of the residue of pots from ancient Mexico and discovered traces of chilies without chocolate. This indicates that either chili sauces were being made or they were used to spice up other beverages about 1,000 years earlier than the Seren archaeological site in El Salvador. Terry Powis, associate professor of anthropology and colleagues at Kennesaw State University in Georgia, have chemically analyzed the residue in 13 pottery vessels, including spouted jars, pots, and vases, dating from 1,700 to 2,400 years ago, that were found at an archaeological site in the state of Chiapas, which was at that time inhabited by the Miche-Zocean people. The best and most direct evidence for chili pepper use in Mesoamerica prior to our study is from Seren, says Powis. So, our work pushes back this date from circa AD 540 to circa 400 BC. To be honest, our study is the only one of its kind to show direct evidence of chili pepper use. In all of the other examples listed in the paper, there is only indirect evidence of chiles and pots found together. We actually linked the two together for the first time, and that is an important development. Therefore, we actually have the earliest known consumption of the peppers. Powis adds, during the mass spec analysis, we were completely surprised by the fact that no cacao was present in any of the pots tested. In fact, chile was present. The exact species of chile present was not identified, but Powis hopes to accomplish that in the future. The most logical species is Capsicum annuum, which was domesticated in Mexico. Because of the absence of cacao and the fact that the artifacts were found in places associated with high-status individuals and rituals, the team speculated that chili peppers were possibly used to produce a spicy beverage, or alternatively, a chili sauce that was stored in the spouted jars and subsequently poured as a dining condiment, possibly during ritual feasts. Powis wonders, was the chili ground up to produce a paste or a salsa and subsequently used as a seasoning in foods that were offered to the Zocayan gods or chiefs? Or were the peppers left whole in the pots? We assume that the presence of chili is in the form of a sauce or paste, and not whole, given that no seeds or other macrofossils were identified in the interiors of the vessels. If the residue is not from a chili paste, was it a spicy beverage other than hot chocolate? Why would there be evidence of chili peppers in a spouted jar? Powis asks in his article. It is commonly assumed that spouted jars were used for pouring a liquid into another container. Perhaps the peppers were not made into a sauce, but a spicy beverage, or alternatively, a chili sauce that was stored in the spouted jars and subsequently poured as a dining condiment. And if the chilies were used in a beverage other than hot chocolate, what might it have been? Further analysis will be required, but two possibilities come to mind. Chicha, the ancient corn beer, or pulque, the precursor to mezcal, which is made from fermented agave sap. If the Mayas and other cultures loved their hot chocolate spiced up with chilies, why not these other favorite beverages? The Mayan civilization had declined considerably by the time the Spanish arrived in Mexico, so there are no Spanish observations about the height of Mayan culture. All that exists today are Mayan hieroglyphics, which are slowly being transliterated, artifacts from Seren, and ethnological observations of the present Maya Indians, whose food habits have changed little in 20 centuries. According to the ethnology volume of the Handbook of Middle American Indians, chiles are highly visible today in areas with a Mayan heritage. Today, in the Yucatan Peninsula, descendants of the Mayas still grow chiles, tomatoes, and onions in boxes or hollowed-out tree trunks that are raised up on four posts for protection against pigs and hens. These container gardens are usually in the yard of the house, near the kitchen. Despite the passage of centuries, the most basic Mayan foods have changed little. Still common are tortillas with bean paste, chilies, and a little squash. Meat, usually chicken or pork, is only consumed about once a week. The Tzeltal Indians of central Chiapas plant chilies in plots about 50 feet on a side, alternating cotton every other year. Interestingly enough, the seeds are planted by women, but only after the men have punched holes in the ground with a planting stick, a ritual with obvious symbolism. The only difference between this method and that used by the Mayas is that the planting sticks today have metal tips. Among the descendants of the Mayas, chili is regarded as a powerful agent to ward off spells. The hot pods are rubbed on the lips of newborn infants and are burned during the funeral ceremonies of viejos, old ones, to defeat evil spirits that might be around. The Aztec tribe of San Carlos Potosí and Veracruz treat victims of the evil eye with chili peppers. An egg is dipped in ground chili and then rubbed on the victim's body to return the pain to the malefactor. The Cicatec Indians of the southern Mexican highlands prepare a tepache, a drink of fermented sugarcane juice with cacao and chili, for use in various rituals. Such a concoction vividly recalls a similar combination of chilies and chocolate consumed by the Aztecs. In 1529, a Spanish Franciscan friar living in Nueva España, present-day Mexico, noted that the Aztecs ate hot red or yellow chili peppers in their hot chocolate and in nearly every dish they prepared. Fascinated by the Aztecs' constant use of a previously unknown spice, Bernardino de Sahagún documented this fiery cuisine in his classic study, Historia General de las Cosas de la Nueva España, now known as the Florentine Codex. His work proves that of all the pre-Columbian New World civilizations, it was the Aztecs who loved chili peppers the most. The marketplaces of ancient Mexico overflowed with chili peppers of all sizes and shapes, including, according to de Sahagún, hot green chilies, smoked chilies, water chilies, tree chilies, beetle chilies, and sharp-pointed red chilies. In addition to some 20 varieties of chiles, as the pungent pods were called in the Nahuatl language, vendors sold strings of red chilies, modern ristras, pre-cooked chilies, and fish chilies, which were the earliest known forms of ceviche, a method of preserving fish without cooking. This technique places the fish in a marinade of an acidic fruit juice and chili peppers. Other seafood dishes were common as well in ancient Mexico. They would eat another kind of stew with frogs and green chili, de Sahagún recorded, and a stew of those fish called axolotl with yellow chili. They also used to eat a lobster stew, which is very delicious. Apparently, the Aztecs utilized every possible source of protein. The friar noted such exotic variations as maguey worms with a sauce of small chilies, newt with yellow chilies, and tadpoles with chiltepetl. De Sahagún classified chilies according to their pungency, as evidenced by the following chart. English, sharp, very sharp, very, very sharp, brilliantly sharp, extremely sharp, sharpest. Nahuatl, cococ, cocopatik, cocopetzpatik, cocopetztik, cocopetzquait, cocopalatik. Spanish, picante, muy picantes, muy, muy picantes, brillantemente picantes, extremadamente picantes, picantísimo. Father de Sahagún, one of the first behavioral scientists, also noted that chilies were revered as much as sex by the ancient Aztecs. While fasting to appease their rather bloodthirsty gods, the priests required two abstentions by the faithful, sexual relations and chili peppers. Chocolate and chilies were commonly combined in a drink called chicahuatl, which was usually reserved for the priests and the wealthy. De Sahagún also discovered the earliest examples of dishes that have since become classics of Mexican cuisine, tamales and moles. The early versions of tamales often used banana leaves as a wrapper to steam combinations of masa dough, chicken, and the chilies of choice. De Sahagún wrote that there were two types of chile mollis, one with red chili and tomatoes, and the other with yellow chili and tomatoes. These chile mollis eventually became the savory mole sauces for which Mexican cuisine is justly famous. Aztec cookery was the basis for the Mexican food of today, and in fact, many Aztec dishes have lasted through the centuries virtually unchanged. Since oil and fat were not generally used in cooking, the foods were usually roasted, boiled, or cooked in sauces. Like the Mayas, the Aztecs usually began the day with a cup of atole, spiced with chili peppers. Aztecs living close to either coast were fond of drinking chilote, a liquor made with pulque, fermented agave pulp, ancho chiles, and herbs. Since pork was not available until the Spanish arrived, the Aztecs would have used pecari, a medium-sized pig-like hoofed animal of the family Tayasuidae meat. The main meal was served at midday and usually consisted of tortillas with beans and a salsa made with chilies and tomatoes. The salsas were usually made by grinding the ingredients between two handheld stones, the molcajetes. Even today, the same technique is used in Indian villages throughout Central America. A remarkable variety of tamales was also served for the midday meal. They were stuffed with fruits, such as plums, pineapple, or guava, with game meat, such as deer or turkey, or with seafood, such as snails or frogs. It was this highly sophisticated chili cuisine that the Spanish encountered during their conquest of the New World. And it all started with the Mayas. Flashback. Out of the ash. The prehistoric chili cuisine of Seren. On an August evening in AD 595, the Loma Caldera, in what is now El Salvador, erupted, sending clouds of volcanic ash into the Mayan agricultural village of Seren, burying it 20 feet deep and turning it into the New World equivalent of Pompeii. Miraculously, all the villagers escaped, but what they left behind gives us a good idea of the life they led, the food they ate, and the chili peppers they grew. In 1976, while leveling ground for the erection of grain silos, a Salvadoran bulldozer operator noticed that he had plowed into an ancient building. He immediately notified the National Museum, but a museum archaeologist thought that the building was of recent vintage and allowed the bulldozing to continue. Several buildings were destroyed. 2 years later, Dr. Payson Sheets, an anthropologist from the University of Colorado, led a team of students on an archaeological survey of the Zapotitan Valley. He was taken to the site by local residents and quickly began a test excavation, and radiocarbon dating of artifacts proved that they were very ancient. He received permission from the government to do a complete excavation of Seren. The site was saved. Dr. Sheets and his students returned for 5 field sessions at Seren, most recently in 1996. Their discoveries are detailed on their website, seren.colorado.edu. Dr. Sheets describes one of their most interesting discoveries. "We had no idea that people in the region lived so well 14 centuries ago." The ash preserved the crops in the field, leaving impressions of the plants. The plants then rotted away, leaving perfect cavities, or molds. Using techniques that were developed at Pompeii, the archaeologists poured liquid plaster into the cavities. By removing the ash, the ancient fields were revealed and could be studied. Interestingly, the Native Americans of Seren used row and furrow techniques similar to those still utilized today. Corn was grown in elevated rows, and beans and squash were grown in the furrows in between. In a courtyard of a building, we even found a series of 4 mature chili plants with stem diameters over 5 centimeters, 2 inches, writes Dr. Sheets. They must have been many years old. Chili peppers are rarely found in archaeological sites in Mesoamerica. So imagine the surprise of the researchers when they discovered painted ceramic storage vessels that contained large quantities of chili seeds. One vessel had cacao seeds in the bottom and chilies above, separated by a layer of cotton gauze, Dr. Sheets reveals. It is possible that they would have been prepared into a kind of mole sauce. Also found were corn kernels, beans, squash seeds, cotton seeds, and evidence of manioc plants and small agave plants, which were used for their fiber to make rope rather than being fermented for an alcoholic beverage, pulque, as was done in Mexico. I emailed Dr. Sheets, hoping to discover the shape and size of the chilies and thus deduce the variety being grown. But no whole pods were found, just the seeds and some pod fragments. The size of the chili stem indicated that the plant had been grown as a perennial, but all chili plants are perennial in tropical climates and can grow to a considerable size. Dr. Sheets wrote me back about an article by Dr. David Lentz, the botanist who had studied the plant remains, and I tracked it down in the Journal of Latin American Antiquity, which I found in the Zimmerman Library at the University of New Mexico. Dr. Lentz writes about the seeds and the pod fragments. It appears that many of these fell from the rafters of buildings where they would have been hung for drying or storage. He adds that the chili seeds from the site were the first in Central America found outside Mexico, and he speculates that those seeds in vessels were probably being saved for future planting. Identifying the Seren chili. But what kind of chili was grown in Seren? There was an intriguing clue in the article. A photograph of a chili seed compared with a bar indicating the length of 1 millimeter. The seed was 3.5 millimeters wide. Since the size of the seed is directly related to the size of the pod, generally speaking, the larger the pod, the larger the seed, perhaps it was possible to guess the size of the pod by comparing that ancient seed to seeds I had stored in my greenhouse. Scientists, including researcher Linda Perry, writing in the journal Science, have proven that chili peppers were domesticated in South America at least by 6,000 years ago. Although very few prehistoric pods and pollen have been found in archaeological sites, a new technique has been developed to track and date the earliest uses of chilies. We found that a widespread but previously unidentified starch morphotype, writes Perry, is derived from chili pepper fruits and is commonly preserved on artifacts. This microfossil was documented in 7 archaeological sites ranging from the Bahamas to the Andes. The starches were recovered from sediment samples, milling stones, and food residues from cooking vessels. The oldest positively identified starches were found at the sites of Loma Alta and Real Alta in southwestern Ecuador, and were dated at 6,000 years before the present, BP. Also found was evidence of maize, corn, squash, beans, and palms. But since Ecuador is not considered to be the center of domestication for any of the 5 domesticated species, the presence of domesticated chilies within this early complex agricultural system indicates that these plants must have been domesticated elsewhere earlier than 6,000 years BP and brought into the region from either the north or the south. The scientists noted that none of the microfossils contained starches typical of the wild species of capsicum, so all of the chilies were grown by the Amerindians living at the sites. The presence of domesticated plants used as condiments rather than as staple foods during the pre-ceramic period indicates that sophisticated agriculture and complex cuisines arose early throughout the Americas, and that the exploitation of maize, root crops, and chili peppers spread before the introduction of pottery, Perry notes. She adds, evidence from both macrobotanical and microbotanical remains indicates that once chili peppers became incorporated into the diet, they persisted. In addition to chili peppers, maize was also present at all 7 sites. Maize and chilies occur together from the onset of this record until European contact, she concludes, and thus represent an ancient neotropical plant food complex. Because chilies cross-pollinate, hundreds of varieties of the 5 domesticated chili species were developed by humans over thousands of years in South and Central America. The color, size, and shape of the pods of these domesticated forms varied enormously. Ripe fruits could be red, orange, brown, yellow, or white. Their shapes could be round, conic, elongate, oblate, or bell-like, and their size could vary from the tiny fruits of chiltepins or tabascos to the large pods of the anchos and pasillas. But very little archaeological evidence existed to support these theories until the finds at Seren. An educated guess. It was exciting to think that perhaps I had a window into the ancient chili domestication process. Because their seeds were collected and the plants were growing in a courtyard, the chili plants at Seren were obviously cultivated and were more than just tolerated weeds. It was time to break out my metric ruler and start measuring seeds. I came up with the following table, ranked by seed width. Variety, ancho. Pod length, 12 centimeters. Seed width, 6 millimeters. Variety, serrano. Pod length, 7 centimeters. Seed width, 5 millimeters. Variety, jalapeno. Pod length, 6.5 centimeters. Seed width, 5 millimeters. Variety, de árbol. Pod length, 4.5 centimeters. Seed width, 5 millimeters. Variety, habanero. Pod length, 4.5 centimeters. Seed width, 4 millimeters. Variety, piquin. Pod length, 1.3 centimeters. Seed width, 4 millimeters. Variety, Seren chili. Pod length, unknown. Seed width, 3.5 millimeters. Variety, chiltepin. Pod length, 0.5 centimeters. Seed width, 3 millimeters. The first conclusion I reached was that the Seren chilies were small podded. They certainly were not as large as anchos, whose seeds are twice the width of those of the Seren chilies. They could, of course, have been chiltepins, because the seeds were only half a millimeter wider than chiltepin seeds. But if they were somewhere between the size of chiltepins and piquins, that would have made the pods about 1 centimeter long, less than half an inch. And since there is evidence that the chili pods had been hung up to dry with agave twine, that process would quickly dry the small potted plants and their fruits. The correlation between seed size and pod length is not exact. Note that the habanero, which is 9 times the length of the chiltepin, has seeds only 1 millimeter wider. Also note that the de árbol variety, which is also 4.5 centimeters long, but much thinner, has seeds only 1 millimeter wider than the Seren chilies. I believe that we are witnessing the early domestication process begun by the Mayan people. The complete domestication of chilies, from chiltepins to anchos, and the development of many varieties, would not happen until the Aztec culture of nearly a millennium after AD 595. This is my personal theory, and I am not a paleoethnobotanist, though sometimes I wish I had studied that discipline. The cuisine of Seren. In addition to the vegetable crops of corn, chilies, beans, manioc, cacao, and squash, the archaeologists found evidence that the Seren villagers also harvested wild avocados, palm fruits, and nuts, and certain spices such as achiote, or annatto seeds. In fact, Dr. Sheets observes, the villagers ate better and had a greater variety of foodstuff than their descendants. Traditional families today eat mostly corn and beans, with some rice, squash, and chilies, but rarely any meat. Seren's residents ate deer and dog meat. They also consumed peccary, mud turtle, duck, and rodent, but deer was their primary meat. Fully 50% of the total bones found on the site belonged to white-tailed deer, and many of those deer were immature animals, giving rise to a very interesting theory. Linda Brown, who wrote the 1996 Field Season Preliminary Report entitled Household and Village Animal Use, notes Seren residents may have practiced some form of deer management. One of the deer procurement strategies the Seren villagers may have utilized is garden hunting. Garden hunting consists of allowing deer to browse in cultivated fields and household gardens where they can be hunted. While some vegetation is lost to browsing, the benefits include easy access to deer when needed. Expanding upon that theory, she writes, the ethnohistoric data make many references to the Maya partially taming white-tailed deer. Specifically, historical sources note that it was women who were responsible for taking in, semi-taming, and raising deer. Diego de Landa mentioned that women raise other domestic animals and let the deer suck their breasts, by which means they raise them and make them so tame that they never will go into the woods, although they take them and carry them through the woods and raise them there. Apparently, during historic times, there was a designated place in the woods where women would take deer to browse until they needed them. Scholars have argued that pre-Columbian women may have raised deer, dogs, peccary, and fowl, much like contemporary Maya women raise pigs and fowl for food, trade, and special occasion feasts. Perhaps the Seren women raised dog, fowl, a duck was tethered inside the household one bodega, and semi-tamed deer as a contribution to the domestic and ceremonial economy. It is always a challenge for archaeologists to reconstruct ancient cuisines and cooking techniques. The Seren villagers did not have metal utensils, but they did have fired ceramics that could be used to boil foods. They could grill over open flames and perhaps fry foods in ceramic pots using cottonseed oil or animal fat. They had obsidian knives that could cut as cleanly as metal. They had metates for grinding corn into flour and morcajetes for grinding fruits, vegetables, chilies, and spices together into sauces. This was the cuisine, extended into the Aztec world, that existed in the New World before the Spanish and Portuguese arrived. Capsicum Conqueror Contact. Christopher Columbus discovered chili peppers in the West Indies on his first voyage to the New World. In his journal for 1493, he wrote, "Also, there is much ají, which is their pepper, and the people won't eat without it, for they find it very wholesome. One could load 50 caravels a year with it in Hispaniola." A caravel was a small Spanish or Portuguese sailing vessel of the Middle Ages. Dr. Diego Chanca, the fleet physician for Columbus on his second voyage, wrote in his journal that the Indians seasoned manioks and sweet potatoes with ají, and that it was one of their principal foods. Of course, both Columbus and his doctor believed that they had reached the Spice Islands, or East Indies. Not only did Columbus misname the Indians, he also mistook chilies for black pepper, thus giving them the inaccurate name, pepper. But he did one thing right. He transported chili seeds back to Europe after his second voyage, which began the chili conquest of the rest of the world. Explorers who followed Columbus to the New World soon learned that chilies were an integral part of the Indians' culinary, medical, and religious lives. In 1526, just 34 years after Columbus's first excursion, El Capitán Gonzalo de Oviedo noted that on the Spanish Main, Indians everywhere grow it, the chili, in gardens and farms with much diligence and attention because they eat it continuously with almost all their food. Bernabé Cobo, a naturalist and historian who traveled throughout Central and South America in the early 17th century, estimated that there were at least 40 different varieties. He wrote, "Some are as large as limes or large plums, others as small as pine nuts or even grains of wheat, and between the two extremes are many different sizes. No less variety is found in color, and the same difference is found in form and shape." He noted that in Peru, next to maize, ají was the plant most beloved of the Indians. Chili peppers were such a novelty to the explorers that rumors were rampant about their medical properties. Wrote the Jesuit priest, poet, and historian José de Acosta in 1590, "Taken moderately, chili helps and comforts the stomach for digestion." The priest had undoubtedly heard about the reputed aphrodisiac qualities of chilies because he continued his description of chili with the following warning. "But if they take too much, it has bad effects, for of itself it is very hot, fuming, and pierces greatly, so the use thereof is prejudicial to the health of young folks, chiefly to the soul, for it provokes to lust." Despite the good father's suspicions, the only thing lustful about chilies was the desire that everyone, including the Spanish, had to devour them. When the Spanish forces under Cortés arrived in Tenochtitlan, now Mexico City, in 1519, they were astounded by the size and complexity of the market at the great plaza of Tlatelolco. According to descriptions by Bernal Díaz de Castillo, it resembled a modern flea market, with thousands of vendors hawking every conceivable foodstuff and other products. The noise of the market could be heard 3 miles away, and some of the soldiers who had traveled to such places as Rome and Constantinople said it was the largest market they had ever seen. Every product had its own section of the market, and chilies were no exception. They were sold in the second aisle to the right. Sometimes chilies were used as a form of money to buy drinks and other small items. Most of the chilies sold in the market had been collected as tribute, a form of taxation used by the Toltecs and Aztecs, and later adopted by the Spanish. The payers of the tribute were the maceguales, the serfs or commoners. The collectors were Indian officials, or, later on, Indian officials who worked for the Spanish. The tribute consisted of locally produced goods or crops that were commonly grown, and the tribute of each village was recorded in boxes on codices of drawn or painted pictographs. According to many sources, chilies were one of the most common tribute items. The chilies were offered to the government in several different forms, as fresh or dried pods, as seed in 200-pound bundles, in willow baskets, and in Spanish bushels. After the chilies and the rest of the produce were moved to the capital, everything was stored in warehouses and closely guarded, and then sold. Chili peppers were considered to be the most valuable of the tributes. One of the most famous tribute codices is the Matricula de Tributos, which is part of the Mendocino Codex. This codex was compiled for the very first viceroy of New Spain, Antonio de Mendoza, who ordered it painted to help inform the emperor, Charles V, of the wealth of what is now Mexico. Glyphs on the codex indicate the tribute paid to the Aztecs by conquered towns just before the Spanish conquest. The towns on one tribute list, in the area of what is now San Luis Potosí, gave 1,600 loads of dry chilies to the imperial throne each year. The Mendocino Codex also reveals an early use of chili peppers in punishment. One pictograph shows a father punishing his 11-year-old son by forcing him to inhale smoke from roasting chilies. The same drawing shows a mother threatening her 6-year-old daughter with the same punishment. Today, the Popolocan Indians who live near Oaxaca punish their children in a similar manner. Wherever they traveled in the New World, Spanish explorers, particularly non-soldiers, collected and transported chili seeds, and thus further spread the different varieties. And not only did they adopt the chili as their own, the Spanish also imported foods that they combined with chilies and other native ingredients to create even more complex chili cuisines. Featured chili pepper, chiltepín. Botanists believe that these wild chilies, Capsicum annuum, variable glabriosculum, are the closest surviving species to the earliest forms of chilies that developed in Bolivia and southern Brazil long before mankind arrived in the New World. The small size of their fruits was perfect for dissemination by birds, and the wild chilies spread all over South and Central America and up to what is now the United States border millennia before the domesticated varieties arrived. It is possible that they have the widest distribution of any wild chili variety. They range from Peru, north to the Caribbean, Florida, and Louisiana, and west to Arizona. There is a wide variation in pod shapes, from tiny ones the size and shape of BBs to elongated pods a half inch long. By contrast, domesticated piquins have much longer pods, up to 3 inches. The chiltepins most prized in Mexico are spherical and measure 5 to 8 millimeters in diameter. They are among the hottest chilies of the annum species, measuring up to 100,000 Scoville heat units. The word chiltepin is believed to be derived from the Aztec language, Nahuatl, combination word chiyi plus tecpintl, meaning flea chili, an allusion to its sharp bite. That word was altered to chiltecpin, then to the Spanish chiltepin, and finally anglicized to chilipiquin, as the plant is known in Texas. In Sonora and southern Arizona, chiltepins grow in microhabitats in the transition zone between mountain and desert, which receive as little as 10 inches of rain per year. They grow beneath nurse trees, such as mesquite, oak, and palmetto, which provide shelter from direct sunlight, heat, and frost. In the summer, there is higher humidity beneath the nurse trees, and legumes, such as mesquite, fix nitrogen in the soil, a perfect fertilizer for the chiltepins. Nurse trees also protect the plant from grazing by cattle, sheep, goats, and deer. Chiltepins planted in the open, without nurse trees, usually die from the effects of direct solar radiation. Although the chiltepin plant's average height is about 4 feet, there are reports of individual bushes growing 10 feet tall, living 25 to 30 years, and having stems as big around as a man's wrist. Chiltepins are resistant to frost, but lose their leaves in cold winter weather. New growth will sprout from the base of the plant if it is frozen back. There is quite a bit of legend and lore associated with the fiery little pods. In earlier times, the Papago Indians of Arizona traditionally made annual pilgrimages into the Sierra Madre range of Mexico to gather chiltepins. Dr. Gary Naban, formerly of Native Seeds/Search in Tucson, discovered that the Tarahumara Indians of Chihuahua value the chiltepins so much that they build stone walls around the bushes to protect them from goats. Besides using them to spice up food, Indians use chiltepins for anti-lactation, the technique where nursing mothers put chiltepin powder on their nipples to wean babies. Chiltepins are also an aid in childbirth because, when powdered and inhaled, they cause sneezing. And of course, the hot chilies induce gustatory sweating, which cools off the body during hot weather. In 1794, Padre Ignaz Pfefferkorn, a German Jesuit living in Sonora, described the wild chili pepper. A kind of wild pepper, which the inhabitants call chiltepin, is found on many hills. It is placed unpulverized on the table in a salt cellar, and each fancier takes as much of it as he believes he can eat. He pulverizes it with his fingers and mixes it with his food. The chiltepin is the best spice for soup, boiled peas, lentils, beans, and the like. Padre Pfefferkorn realized that chiltepins are one of the few crops in the world that are harvested in the wild rather than cultivated. Others are piñon nuts, Brazil nuts, and some wild rice. This fact has led to concern for the preservation of the chiltepin bushes because the harvesters often pull up entire plants or break off branches. Dr. Naban believes that the chiltepin population is diminishing because of overharvesting and overgrazing. In Arizona, a chiltepin reserve has been established near Tumacacori at Rock Corral Canyon in the Coronado National Forest. Native Seeds/Search has been granted a special use permit from the National Forest Service to initiate permanent marking and mapping of plants, ecological studies, and a management plan proposal. Yo soy un chiltepinero. My amigo, Antonio Heras, swears that the motto of the Sonoran bus lines is better dead than late, and I believe him. The smoke-belching buses were flying by us on curves marked by shrines commemorating the unfortunate drivers whose journey through life had abruptly ended on this mountain road. We waved the buses on and cruised along at a safer speed to enjoy the spectacular vistas on the way to the Valley of the Chiltepineros. It was November 1990, the time of the Sonoran chiltepin harvest, yet the temperature was in the upper 80s. My wife, Mary Jane, and I had accepted the invitation of Antonio Heras to visit the home of his mother, Josefina, the chili queen, who lives in the town of Cumpas. From there, we journeyed through the spectacular scenery of the foothills of the Sierra Madre range, Chiltepin country. Our destination was the Rio Sonora Valley and the villages of La Aurora and Mazocahui. As we drove along, Antonio and I reminisced about our fascination with the wild chili pepper. During the early days of the Chili Pepper magazine, both of us had attended a symposium on wild chilies that was held in October 1988 at the Desert Botanical Garden in Phoenix. The leader of the conference was the ecologist Dr. Gary Naban, author of Gathering the Desert, director of Native Seeds/Search, and an expert on chiltepins. Other chili experts attending included Dr. W. Hardy Eshbaugh, a botanist from Miami University of Ohio, Dr. Jean Andrews, author of Peppers, the Domesticated Capsicums, and Cindy Baker of the Chicago Botanical Garden. The symposium on wild chilies was fascinating, and we even got to taste some chiltepin ice cream. But it was even more interesting to see the chiltepineros in action 2 years later. In the Village of the Dawn. The only way to drive to the Village of the Dawn, La Aurora, is to ford the Rio Sonora, which was no problem for Antonio's jeep. The first thing we noticed about the village was that nearly every house had thousands of brilliant red chiltepins drying on white linen cloths in their front yards. We stopped at the modest house of veteran chiltepinero Pedro Osuna and were immediately greeted warmly and offered liquid refreshment. As Pedro measured out the chiltepins he had collected for Antonio and Josefina, we asked him about the methods of the chiltepineros. He said that the Durans advanced him money so he could hire pickers and pay for expenses such as gasoline. Then he would drive the pickers to ranches where the bushes were numerous. He dropped the pickers off alongside the road, and they wandered through the rough cattle country, hand-picking the tiny pods. In a single day, a good picker could collect only 6 quarts of chiltepins. At sunset, the pickers returned to the road, where Pedro met them. The ranchers who owned the land would later be compensated with a liter or so of pods. Usually, the pods would be dried in the sun for about 10 days. But because that technique is lengthy and often results in the pods collecting dust, Antonio had built a solar dryer in the back of Pedro's house. Air heated by a solar collector rose up a chimney through racks, with screens holding the fresh chiltepins, a much more efficient method. Modern technology, based upon ancient solar passive principles, had arrived at the Village of the Dawn. I asked Pedro how the harvest was going, and he said it was the best in more than a decade because the better-than-average rainfall had caused the bushes to set a great many fruits. Antonio added that during the drought of 1988, chiltepins were so rare that there was no export crop. According to Pedro, factors other than rainfall also had an influence on the harvest, specifically birds and insects. Mockingbirds, Pyroluxia, Mexican cardinals, and other species readily ate the pods as they turned red, but the real damage to the entire plant was caused by grasshoppers. The total harvest in Sonora is difficult to estimate, but at least 20 tons of dried pods are collected and sold in an average year. Some chiltepineros have suggested that in a wet year like 1990, 50 tons might be a better estimate. The total export to the United States is estimated at more than 6 tons a year, and the Durans account for much of that. As I watched Antonio and his mother weigh huge sacks of chiltepins on the small scale in front of the market, I asked Antonio about prices. He declined to tell me what he paid the chiltepineros, but he offered a wealth of information about other pricing information. Between 1968 and 1990, the wholesale price of chiltepins multiplied nearly tenfold. Between 1987 and 1990, the price nearly tripled, mostly because of the 1988 drought. Currently, chiltepins are being sold in South Tucson in 1/4 ounce packages for $2, which equates to a phenomenal $128 per pound. Thus, Chiltepins are the second most expensive spice in the world, after saffron. Why do people in the United States lust after these tiny pods? Dr. Naban suggests that chiltepins remind immigrants of their northern Mexico homeland and help them reinforce their Sonoran identity. Also, chiltepins have traditional uses in Sonoran cuisine, as evidenced by the recipes we collected. In addition to spicing up Sonoran foods, they are an antioxidant and thus help preserve carne seca, the dried meat we call jerky. No wonder the Chili Queen and her son work hard to import many hundreds of pounds of pods. After the sacks of chiltepins were loaded into the Jeep, we were joined by Arizona Republic reporter Keith Rosenblum, who was writing a story on the chiltepineros. We went for lunch in the nearby village of Mazocahui, passing signs reading, "Se vende chiltepin," chiltepins for sale. At the rustic restaurant, which was really the living room of someone's house, we sat down for a fiery feast. Bowls of chiltepins were on the table, and the extremely hot salsa casera was served with carne adobada, carne machaca, beans, and the superb, extremely thin Sonoran flour tortillas. Back in the town of Cumpas, loud salsa music enlivened the streets as if a fiesta were in progress. Josefina and her assistant Evalia prepared a wonderful chiltepin-spiced meal. We drank some bacanora, the magical Mexican moonshine, and dined on an elegant and highly spiced menu of Sonoran specialties. I felt inspired. After submerging myself in the chiltepin culture of Sonora, I was very comfortable in saying, "Yo soy un chiltepinero." I am a chiltepinero. Recipes. Based on the archaeological evidence, I have devised some recipes that reflect the main ingredients used in the cooking of the Mayas, from Seren in particular, the Incas, and the Aztecs, adapted, of course, for modern kitchens. One of my basic theories about the history of cooking is that we should never underestimate our predecessors' culinary sophistication. So I cannot presume that as far back as 14 centuries ago, the Mayas were preparing boring food, especially since we know that they had chilies. Spicy calabacitas. Yield, 4 to 6 servings. Heat scale, medium. This recipe combines 3 Native American crops, squash, corn, and chilies. Although we don't know for sure, my theory is that the Seren villagers would have known how to use green chilies. I have taken the liberty of substituting New Mexican chilies for the small Serenian chilies, making a milder dish. The villagers, of course, would not have used butter, milk, or cheese, but rather fat and water flavored with palm fruits. 1/2 cup chopped green New Mexican chilies, roasted, peeled, stems removed. 3 zucchini squash, cubed. 1/2 cup chopped onion. 4 tablespoons butter or margarine. 2 cups whole kernel corn. 1 cup milk. 1/2 cup grated Monterey Jack cheese. In a pan, sauté the squash and onion in the butter until the squash is tender. Add the chilies, corn, and milk. Simmer the mixture for 15 to 20 minutes to blend the flavors. Add the cheese and heat until the cheese is melted. Chocolatl, royal chocolate with chili. Yield, 1 serving. Heat scale, medium. Although this drink was served to royalty in the large Mayan cities, the discovery of chili in conjunction with cacao in Seren indicates that even commoners knew how to make this concoction. 1.5 cups of water. 1/4 cup unsweetened cocoa powder, not instant hot chocolate mix. 1 tablespoon honey. 1/4 teaspoon hot chili powder, such as chiltepin. 1 vanilla bean pod. In a pan, heat the water to boiling. Add the remaining ingredients and stir well. Serve immediately with the vanilla bean for garnish in the drink. Red Snapper Fillet.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.